Good evening. How nice to see everyone here, despite our subway issues in the district today. I'm Jane McAuliffe. I'm the Director of National and International Outreach here at the Library of Congress. National and International Outreach, or NIO, as we call it, because we give acronyms to absolutely everything in the Library of Congress, is a new division of the library dedicated to making the library and its resources ever more available to the American people. And an important part of NIO is the Center for the Book, whose director we have with us tonight, John Cole. The Center for the Book is responsible for a number of things, but especially some major programs for the library, such as the National Book Festival, which is now in its 16th year, and I hope all of you will be with us next September 24th for this annual celebration of our greatest authors, poets, and illustrators. The Center for the Book also prepares the librarian's selection of the U.S. Poet Laureate, a position currently held by Juan Felipe Herrera. And Mr. Herrera's final event as Poet Laureate this year will be on April 13th in the Coolidge Auditorium. And again, we hope many of you will be able to join us. And finally, the Center for the Book has spearheaded the Library of Congress Literacy Awards program. Through the generosity of David Rubenstein, the library has been able to recognize and to make awards to literacy organizations, both in this country and overseas. And the Literacy Awards brings us to this evening's program and its focus on how literacy affects our health and well-being. Being able to read is essential to our ability to obtain, to process, and to understand basic health information and services. If we cannot read, we can't get the instruction necessary to make informed decisions about medical care and about lifestyle adjustments. And that brings us to our symposium's co-sponsor, the Nemours Foundation, which is an integrated children's health system. It has hospitals in the Delaware Valley and in Florida and operates 45 primary, specialty, and urgent care clinics. Nemours is responsible for the website Kids Health, the most visited internet site for information about health, behavior, and development for children right through the teen years, Kids Health. And it's become a very prominent voice for children's health care under the leadership of its president and CEO, Dr. David Bailey. Dr. David Bailey, a pediatric gastroenterologist, has been CEO of Nemours for 10 years. He took his undergraduate degree at West Virginia University, majoring, not unexpectedly, in biology, and then did his MD at Penn State. His residency program took him here to Washington, D.C., where he was at Walter Reed Army Medical Center, and then to service in the Army Medical Corps in Alabama, Florida, and Hawaii. After leaving the military, Dr. Bailey established the Division of Pediatric Gastroenterology at the Arnold Palmer Hospital for Children in Orlando, and he also did an MBA at the University of Florida. So he is the perfect person, I think, to bring to us some real information around the topic of literacy and health. Please welcome Dr. David Bailey.
Thank you very much, Jane, for that very kind introduction. I just wish my kids could have heard it. You know, I also want to welcome all of you to this symposium, which explores the critical linkage between literacy and health. It seems fitting that this event is held here at the Library of Congress, which is one of the world's foremost repositories of knowledge and accumulated wisdom. We have a full day of speakers tomorrow, and I think you'll find them both illuminating and thought-provoking. Before I begin, I want to take this opportunity to recognize the foresight and generosity of David M. Rubenstein, founder of the Library of Congress Literacy Awards. This symposium exploring the connections between literacy and health is made possible through his generous gift to the Library of Congress and reflects his keen interest in drawing public attention to the importance of literacy in all segments of society. Although his schedule would not allow him to be with us tonight or tomorrow, I'm sure he would be very pleased with our commitment to learn from each other and to engage others in this very important work going forward. Now tonight, I would like to tell a story that I hope will connect us in a very real way to why we're here. This is a story of a boy, the eldest of three children, who grew up in Wyco, a southern West Virginia coal mining holler. Not hollow, that's holler in West Virginia. That was gouged out of a narrow valley where the railroad track and the dirt road roughly paralleled the creek running out of the mountains. His father had dropped out of the eighth grade to support his own mother and his six siblings. The boy's mother was 18 when he was born, and she did have a high school diploma. In that coal mining community, practically every male over the age of 16 worked in the coal mines. Coal dust was constant. It was on everything and everybody. Families lived paycheck to paycheck. And after every paycheck, drinking was the major recreational activity for several days. Practically all goods for daily living came from the company store, which was owned, sure enough, by the coal company. At one time or another, almost everyone received what were known as government commodities, usually cheese and peanut butter. Poverty was pervasive, but as there was nothing to compare to, it was just life for the residents of Wyco. At the pleading of his mother, the boy was accepted on a trial basis into the first grade at the age of 5. He was bored because all of his playmates were then in school. He joined the other 5 students, all male, who comprised the entire first grade class. The school had 2 rooms with 3 grades in each room, each grade composed of 1 row of desks. To the casual observer, the boy's family was indistinguishable from any other in Wyco. However, there were 3 very important differences. His father did not drink. His mother had a high school diploma and loved to read, primarily romance novels. And both parents placed a high importance on education. Unlike all of his friends, there were reading materials appropriate for age in his home. In fact, the only time he ever saw books or magazines outside of his home was at school. His family once fell prey to a door-to-door salesman and bought a full set of Encyclopedia Britannica. Remember, this was a long time before Google. These encyclopedias became a prized possession and were proudly displayed in the front room. For Christmas, just before his 8th birthday, the boy received a children's book about Edward Jenner, the 18th century British physician who pioneered smallpox vaccination. This book ignited his desire to pursue a medical career. At age 16, he entered college, the first person from both his extended family and from Wyco to do so. He went on to medical school at age 19 and stands before you this evening. I am that boy. What happened to the other 5 boys who made up the first class in Wyco, West Virginia? Tom graduated from high school, worked in the mines, and died of coal miner's black lung about 10 years ago. Bill dropped out of school, worked a while in the coal mines, and then became a hermit in the hills around Wyco. Mark dropped out of school and was in and out of prison, largely for theft-related offenses. Jim graduated from high school but was severely injured in a coal mining accident and lives on Social Security disability. And I lost track of my fifth classmate. Based on empirical data, it's now widely accepted that access to printed materials is the critical variable affecting reading acquisition. The complete lack of available reading materials almost assured that the five of the six boys would not be reading at grade level when they reached the fourth grade. That alone vastly increased the likelihood that one of them, or many of them, would drop out of high school, which in turn increased the likelihood of unemployment by over 70% when compared to high school graduates. In retrospect, Mark and Bill's lives, the ones who dropped out, were sadly both a statistical and a cultural norm. My other two friends hardly fared better. Jim's accident and Tom's premature death cannot be surprises, given the difficult environment in which they lived and worked. People who are illiterate or poor, and they are very closely linked, are more likely to work under hazardous conditions or be exposed to environmental toxins. Most of you here could have predicted in general terms what would have happened to those boys in the first grade class. Unfortunately, more than 50 years later, in countless places, but with different faces, this story is still playing out. It's like a perverse real-life version of the movie Groundhog Day, in which the same day gets repeated over and over and over until the protagonist gets it right. What does this story have to do with literacy and health? Everything. Literacy dramatically affects the outcomes in medical care. However, literacy may be even more impactful in those areas that are now recognized as having a much larger role in shaping the health of populations than medical care alone. A large and compelling body of evidence accumulated over the past 25 years leaves little room for doubt about the powerful role of social factors in health. The phrase social determinants of health has been coined to reflect this and is defined as the conditions in which people are born, grow, live, work, and age, and includes the fundamental drivers of those conditions. These social determinants have been categorized into four separate dimensions: social circumstances, behaviors, the environment, and genetics. Education, poverty, and housing powerfully influence health. For instance, for the population as a whole, the most consistent predictor of the likelihood of death in any given year is the level of education. And the close links of poverty to health have been known for centuries. However, behavior patterns, diet, physical activity, sexual activity, addiction, and the like, behavior is the single greatest influence over health in the United States. All told, multiple studies using different methodologies show that the social determinants shape about 85% of the health of populations, with medical care making up the other 15%. Let me repeat that. Social determinants shape 85% of the health of populations, with medical care making up the other 15%. Another way to look at this is through a study released by the Department of Health and Human Services, in which they estimate that the 30 years of increased life expectancy attained in the 20th century, only about 5 of those years can be attributed to better medical care. The direct impact of low literacy on health outcomes is broad and significant for both children and adults. The weight of evidence shows that lower literacy is directly correlated with greater number of hospitalizations, more outpatient visits, less tight diabetes control, more complications from diabetes, including blindness, cardiovascular disease, and neuropathy, more emergency room visits, more hospitalizations for asthma, and I could go on and on. Patients with lower literacy are also much less likely to participate in screening and prevention. These include childhood immunizations, smoking cessation programs, pap smears, mammograms, colonoscopies. The Center for Healthcare Strategies also indicates nearly half of Americans have difficulty understanding and using health information. This impedes their ability to make appropriate health decisions for themselves and for their children. An example of this is one study in which 43% of the participants were found to have reading levels below the sixth grade level. These patients were 3.4 times more likely to not take their prescription medications correctly. Overall, people who read at lower literacy levels are 3 times more likely to have adverse medical outcomes than people who can read at higher literacy levels. There are very few high-quality studies assessing a direct impact of literacy on cost related to specific disease entities. A problem is that the confounding factors have been very difficult to control. But one study of non-pregnant Medicaid recipients found that those adult patients with a reading level at or below the third grade had Medicaid charges over 3.5 times those patients whose reading level was above the third grade. In aggregate, low literacy is estimated to add about $230 billion to the country's healthcare costs each year. I believe that the next great leap in improving the health of the nation will not come out of the laboratory, the operating room, with a new medication, or with new processes, but rather through systematically addressing the social determinants of health, or, to use the current terminology, moving healthcare upstream. I also believe that the key to enabling this leap is improving the literacy rate in the United States. If you consider the direct links of literacy, or the lack of literacy, to education, risky behaviors, high school dropout rates, incarceration, and welfare, it does not require any suspension of belief to understand that literacy is the tool to not just improve overall health, but to break the intergenerational cycle of poverty and its associated morbidities. As I've touched on briefly, literacy has profound effects on medical care and the social determinants of health. Turning the question around, can medical care and healthcare systems affect literacy? At Nemours, our core operating principle is that our responsibility to children is more than the diagnosis and treatment of disease. We believe that we are shared guardians of children's health and joy. We believe reading and literacy are essential for both health and joy. Nemours established our Bright Start program in 2005, which is aimed at improving reading readiness. We had the great fortune to have Dr. Laura Baylett here with us tonight, lead Bright Start. In view of the tremendous efforts by so many parties, Laura believed that identifying children at an early age with reading vulnerabilities would provide greater value, giving a chance for intervention before brain developmental patterns are set. We'll have a chance to hear more from Dr. Baylett tomorrow. But in brief, she and her team developed and validated the tool for early screening. And the screening has identified that 20% or more of pre-kindergarten children have reading vulnerabilities. The Bright Start team has also developed a 9 to 12 hour intervention delivered over several weeks that brings about 2/3 of these children back to the normal range. And in hopes of enabling universal screening, the team has recently refined and validated a tool that can be used by parents. In addition to our dedicated reading readiness effort, we know that education and literacy are negatively impacted by chronic disease and the absenteeism frequently associated with it. For that reason, we've piloted a community health effort for chronic disease using asthma as a model. We have involved community health workers as health navigators, community liaisons as health integrators, and these assess the patient's home, provide ongoing education, and connect the family to community resources. The community liaisons also interface and influence both governmental and non-governmental agencies, such as housing, pest control, transportation, and health specialty resources. Furthermore, with parental permission, we've piloted providing school nurses full access to the child's electronic health record in order to close any gaps in communication or in handoffs. Because of these efforts, outcomes are better, much better, and school absences have decreased. Nemours and health systems nationwide are searching to find concrete ways to improve the health of populations. This has become a primary goal of health reform. After generations of treating patients one by one, changing mindset is a very real obstacle. Impacting the health of populations requires a deep understanding of the social determinants of health, as well as working with community resources in new and unfamiliar ways. It requires moving from a command and control mode to true collaboration. For a significant change, it also requires a move from a fee-for-service model of reimbursement to a value-based model of care, where outcomes instead of volume are reimbursed, and those outcomes must include some population health measures. As a note, reimbursement models are not unilaterally set by health systems, and both payers and providers need to have the infrastructure and systems in place to successfully transition to a new model of reimbursement. And value-based healthcare is 180 degrees apart from fee-for-service-based healthcare. So it requires complete systems change. Despite all the policy discussions, money allocated, and the multitude of programs, both private and public, the nation's literacy rate has only slightly improved over the last decade. The responsibility for a child's care, including literacy, will always fall principally to the parents. It is they who, with knowledge, understanding, and the right tools, can do the most for the child, particularly in those critical first 1,000 days after birth, when brain development is rapid and the potential for positive influence is at its greatest. The American Academy of Pediatrics Books Build Connections Literacy Toolkit is a wonderful example of empowering parents for success. It also provides a clear roadmap for early screening and intervention for care providers, and it's a remarkable illustration of great collaboration and alignment among organizations. You'll likely hear more about this from Dr. Hassink in her keynote address tomorrow morning. We in healthcare must play a larger and more proactive role than we traditionally have. For children, this means aggressively addressing those health determinants that interfere with skill acquisition, both at a very early age and during the school years. We at Nemours believe that child health and reading skills are closely linked, and that reading failure is a major child health issue. For that reason, we will continue to promote reading success through innovative programs, research, advocacy, and partnerships focusing on birth to age 8. In conclusion, the challenge for us all is how to intervene in the lives of the nation's children so that their future is one of choice rather than being dictated by circumstance. Literacy is that enabler of individual choice, and it is at the heart of it all. When I reflect on my personal story, multiple adverse circumstances were overcome by being lucky enough to have a mother who created an environment conducive to reading. With the expertise and commitment of all of you here tonight, and your colleagues in the symposium tomorrow, the fate of the next generation of children, and thus of our nation's future, will not be left to chance. Thank you very much.
Dr. Bailey has agreed to take a few questions, so if there are...
Did you see her twist my arm? She's tough. I'd be happy to take any questions. I appreciate that. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you. That's one of the best speeches on literacy I've ever heard. So thank you very much. it felt to me like it really felt like that was a call to action. And I'm curious, what are some of the policy on the policy? What are some of the policy things that we need to do to take that call to action and move it forward?
You know, I think, great question. I wish I had all the answers. I think that there's been a tremendous amount of work over the past 10 years, and it's accelerated over the past 5 years. We now have a national agenda around literacy because there is a much more dedicated approach to using data in order to make decisions. It gets people on board, it gets people from both political parties on board, and the mayors of the nation have actually been driving this, I think, more than anyone else. It really falls to the local communities. But when I think about it, what can we do more? And I think that you have these two great efforts. Healthcare, which consumes $3 trillion a year, and you have the education budget, and you have this giant literacy effort. In some ways, they're kind of in silos. And certainly the literacy data and the health data have both landed on the social determinants of health. That is where we can make a difference. And I think even greater emphasis on attempting to intervene early in that first 1,000 days. I think that is the critical learning period in which developmental pathways can be positively altered, and it requires far less money and effort to do that. So what does that mean? I think we need to start on the OB side, actually. I think that with prenatal visits, mothers need to be informed how critical reading, talking, and singing are to their newborn baby. I don't know if to the fetus is where we need to go, but maybe. But beyond that, having literacy be a primary point on which the entire medical team, OB, pediatrics, family practice, gets on board. You know, the American Academy of Pediatrics has a fabulous policy statement and developed fabulous materials. A minority of pediatricians actually do it. And the reasons are many, you know, time, potentially reimbursement. Other factors include not knowing, not being comfortable with the tools. Are the tools really validated? And not being comfortable about, are there folks in the community who can truly intervene once we've identified potential reading vulnerabilities? And I think the new toolkit that the AAP has come up with helps them with that if, you know, once it gets massively distributed. So I believe alignment, not just within silos, because I think the literacy world seems to be pretty well aligned, but aligning the effort with healthcare, with policy, with education, then I think we can really make a difference. For instance, with education, it is very difficult to break into the school system. For someone in healthcare to run a study longitudinally over several grades to understand if the intervention is really having a long-term effect. And I think that if we can find ways to break those silos such that the large different pieces can then come together, I think we'll make much faster progress. I think there's, in effect, there's a lot of money out there. You know, there's probably 30 to 40% of healthcare is probably wasted. If we can reduce that waste and apply it to this type of effort and education, I think over the long haul, you'll see a healthier population. The problem is the will to do it. You know, it's difficult to make that type of massive change. But if we could just gain some alignment between all the different large constituencies, I think we'd make bigger progress. Jane.
I'm curious about your focus on the first 1,000 days. I mean, certainly many of us have seen recent research about the importance of aligning the rich environment and the thousands more words that children who are the offspring of very educated parents here as opposed to children with much less education. Looking at it from another angle, what are some of the signs that
I think, you know, well child care tends to focus, as it should, on all of the developmental milestones. You know, walking, talking, when can they roll over, and the like. I think having a more comprehensive or refined set of tools that are simple, easy to deliver, to evaluate language and potential reading ability. And you know, the physician doesn't need to be the one doing it. There could be community resources that could come into the office and be responsible for that type of screening. What would prevent that from happening is the physician believing that it's reliable, you know, that it's providing good data and having the ability to refer to a someone that is known to intervene appropriately. So I think a better, a more refined, more comprehensive screening of speech, language, and pre-reading abilities would put us forward a great deal. Laura.
You're at risk, and we can argue
Right.
Art. It's just partly a matter of getting it out there and having people have that shared accountability that together we all have to do it.
You know, there are several studies that show that families who were originally middle class in terms of socioeconomic status, but through some traumatic event, they are in poverty. The income has dropped so much and they live in poverty. And even if they are able to lift themselves up out of poverty after 15 months, the 1 year spent in poverty leads to, on average, a delay in a reading level that for a slight majority of those children, they don't catch up, even though the family is now back into middle class status. And I don't know if they don't catch up because there's no added intervention, it's not recognized, but relatively brief, if you can call a year in poverty brief, adverse circumstances, traumas like that, can have a significant effect on literacy. And so as a society, and as Robert mentioned, you know, if a pediatric practice is the primary medical home for that child, the physician, the caregiver, those people in the office know and understand when those traumatic occurrences happen, and can then begin to alert the family as to what resources they may be able to avail themselves in the community in order to prevent that reading level being stunted or perhaps intervening to bring it back up. I think it requires, that old cliche, it requires a village. It does require all of the access points to children and family to ensure that that child reaches their optimal development. And so I think in terms of pediatricians' offices, that's a primary place, but it's up to all of us in the community in order to understand the significant effect that traumas or other delays can have on reading level, and thus the future for that child and even the future for society. Yes. Can you clone him? Can you clone him? I think it's a wonderful idea. I wouldn't have thought of it myself, but I think it is a wonderful idea. I think it may be very difficult to change the behavior of pediatricians who have been out in practice, and there are about 64,000 of them. I think the chances would be great, however, if that were presented as an option or as an approach during training programs. That it would be very easy to do that, and I think that it would be it wouldn't take very long in order to build a data set to show how positive it is, and in fact how it may shorten the time spent necessary in a well-child exam. So I think it's a fabulous idea. Yes. Well, you've been very kind. Thank you very much.